Hi, here I am back with some of your requests from the past video about the Spectator camera, especially the 360 degree rotation requested by ItsPlayZZHD, location saving requested by IT ATI Project, and collisions requested by FishZone. Additionally from me, we're gonna also implement path saving and replay with reverse functions, so let's get started. First thing we're gonna do is preparing the inputs. Let's start with the axis mappings. Those are gonna be used for things like movement because they're updated every frame. Afterwards, we're gonna add the action mappings, which are for single fire events. After we added all of them, let's add corresponding buttons, set their values, and bind the keyboard buttons to the input events. You can bind them as you wish, but here's how I've set it up. The inputs are ready. Now let's add the pound we're gonna control, and we're gonna also add a widget for the, let's say, more advanced functionality and stuff. But first, let's open the pound to add some movement functionality to it. First, we wanna add a sphere collision and set it as a root component. I'm gonna also change the size a bit. Now let's add a camera and do some first movement scripting in the event graph. Let's find the move forward input first. This is the axis input event, and like said, update this every frame. The axis value equals 0 when we press no buttons assigned to this event and can get up or down to a value specified in the input section. We're gonna use that with the add actor local offset. Let's split the vector into 3 floats and do a little math. In the inputs, the value ranges from minus 1 to positive 1. We're gonna multiply that by a value we will call speed, we will also be able to control. This applies to x-axis for move forward and y-axis for move sideways. Now we wanna test it out. We could place the pound on the level, but I'm gonna do something different. We're gonna add a game mode, as we cannot change the pound in the default game mode, assign the pound we created, and assign the game mode in the project settings. Now as you can see, we can move around, but that's a little boring, so let's add a rotation to our mouse axis events. Now we're gonna add world rotation on the Z axis, not the relative because that would work not as intended, but we're gonna add the relative rotation to the Y axis so we can look up and down. Now it looks better as I am able to freely fly around, but there's an issue. Oh yeah, that surely looks broken. But how are you gonna fix that? We're gonna use a different node to rotate our little pawn. We're gonna use the add actor local rotation and add actor world rotation instead, and now it's working as expected. Now you can rotate 360 degrees and look upside down. Isn't that great? Alright, we nailed this one. Now let's add some more functionality by using the input action events to speed up and down by mouse wheel. First, we're gonna block further changes if the values are lower or higher than 50 and 1 respectively, and if true, increment or decrement the value. I hope you still remember where we used the speed float. Now let's do the vertical movement. If you add actor local offset, it's gonna go up and down relatively to your rotation. If you want to just move up and down regardless of your rotation, you need to add actor world offset instead. Do not forget to enable the sweep option so the sphere will be blocked by collisions. Here you can see the speed test. The movement looks already good with what we have until now, but let's add something more cool. First, let's organize our stuff with some nice comments to be aware what is what on the graph. Now let's play with the save location, but for that we will need the widget. Let's start with adding some side panel image. Nothing too hard to create, I think. Now some random button, but more importantly, we need some sort of list. So let's add a scroll box. And also to it, we're gonna add some background so it's gonna be visible where it exists. To make sure the images will not disturb us and are not clickable, we're gonna change their visibility to make it possible. Now we want to actually add something to the list, so let's create one more widget and give it some name. Inside of it, we're gonna add a button with anchors that will stretch it to the horizontal size of the parent. Now some fancy text that will represent the name, and also let's give it some color. Now that's how you'll see it in the game. Let's also make some changes to the panel. We're gonna add a text to the top, replace the button and place some more for the system we're creating. We want to be able to teleport to selected location, be able to rename it and of course remove. After we're done here and we're satisfied with the look, let's create a binding to the isEnabled state. With this you're not gonna be able to click on a button until the condition is met, which in our case is gonna be checking if the scroll box contains any children attached to it. Let's make the text to be a variable, change its name, and this is gonna represent our selection. This will have an interesting usage. Let's head back to our isEnabled binding, and we're gonna add an AND boolean node, so only if both requirements are met, the buttons are gonna be available and we'll simply compare the text to see if we have anything selected. We could create the same binding for the other buttons, but in fact, there is no need to. If the code is same, we can simply reuse the binding we created for the first button. I wanted to change the name of it, but I was kinda stuck with it, so I gave up after a moment and went back to further scripting. On the begin play of our pawn, we're gonna create a widget, promote to variable and then add to viewport. Now in the widget that we assign as a child, we need some variables too, and those are the location and a name, so let's create them there. We also want them to be exposed on spawn. Now by the pawn in the input action for saving the location, we're gonna create the child widget, assign the actual location, and for the name, we're gonna append a few texts together. First a name, we're gonna have a lock for location, then the ID of the item on the list so they appear different, and at the end we're gonna add the location as well. After we created it and assigned values, we're gonna add it as a child of the scroll box from our widget, which we referenced at the plugin play. Now we also need the selection system for the buttons list, so let's head to the widget and add a new variable with the type of child widget we're adding. This is gonna allow us to recognize if there's anything selected or not, or if we click the same thing. We already have variables inside of our child of the list. We're gonna create a binding for the text that's gonna appear on the top. Let's bring up the selected location and check if it's valid, and just for your information, by default it's not valid, and in that case we wanna show that minus symbol. But if it should be valid, we wanna show up the name of the child widget. Now inside of the child widget itself, we're gonna assign the onClick event for the button, cast to our pawn, get the widget reference, and in there we want to set the selected location variable, so basically fill with information about self when it was clicked. Now the variable becomes valid as well, so this will affect the text. We also need a little trick here to recognize if we clicked on the button and if it's the same button as already assigned, and if true, we want to disable the selection by making the reference empty and therefore invalid to reset the text to be minus symbol again. For false, it's gonna assign the actual child widget to make it valid and filled with information. Now let's add functionality to the buttons by adding onClicked events. For teleport, we wanna cast to the pawn and set actor location to teleport it. The location is stored in the assigned child widget. Remember that the button is not available if nothing is selected. Now the rename button. We need some system for that as well. Let's add a text box where the player can enter the name. We need also some visibility rules, so let's add a binding there as well. We're gonna add a new boolean called renaming, and depending on that we're gonna make it visible or not. Now when we click on the rename button, it's gonna enable the visibility. Now let's add on text committed event for the text box to affect the name and reset the renaming boolean back to false, so it's gonna disappear. And the final button, remove. We're gonna take the actual child widget and remove it from the scroll box. Now it's time for a little test. And the mouse is not visible, so let's show it and hide it with left alt by getting the controller and changing the mouse visibility. Let's test it again. We can press F to create a teleport. Select one of them so the buttons will become active, and let's try it out a bit. As you can see, it already works pretty fine. Let's change the text visibility option so it will not block the collision by being on top of the button. But there's still something more to do about the wall system. We obviously want to highlight our selection. Let's add a set background color of the button and assign some nice colors to the states, and also make sure to set the button default color to match the inactive color. But there's an issue. We can select multiple objects, or at least it appears that it happens, so we need to prevent that. Let's move those nodes down and create custom events or functions for them. Now, whenever we click on a new child widget, we're gonna loop through all of the items in the list to check for the active one, deactivate it, and activate the new one. We're gonna use all children of the scroll box to make a for each loop. Actually, it wasn't necessary for the true value, as we could simply do it directly with the self reference, but yeah, I did the loop anyway. Also, it should be for each loop with break to actually stop the process once one of them was found, because we can have only one selection at a time. So yeah, it's for your information. It's working either way, kind of same. Oh, and for the bottom loop on the completed, add the highlight node to highlight the actual selection. I messed up the nodes and I had to invert them, but it's working as expected. So that's done. We have a nice teleport system on a list, and now let's add the final thing. The path recording, yes! I'm gonna cover that one too. Let's make something similar to the top section. Add the scroll box with the background, add a play button and a checkbox to decide if we wanna play it backwards. For the play button, we obviously want to bind the is enabled as well. I'm not gonna cover it here, you should be able to do it already. I believe in you. Once we have the buttons, we need some code as well. Let's start by adding a boolean to check if we're recording, and create a custom event, which is gonna be a timer to record the location over time. Let's grab the widget reference, get the path scroll box, it's gonna contain the locations list. We're gonna create the same child widget, assign the location, which also will be the visible name, and then we add it to the second scroll box for the path. Now, if we're not recording, we want to start it and assign the boolean to be true, and if we are recording right now, we want to stop it and set the boolean to false. Before we start a new recording, we want to clear out the array. Let's add the clear node. I'm going to add a little loop because sometimes it's not totally empty, and as long as it's not, it's gonna repeat the clear process. Now let's assign something to the play button. First of all, we'll add a new boolean to check if we're playing the path already. Let's also add a new integer to follow the actual step of the path and use it to determine the movement. At first, we're gonna get first 2 points to start with. Unfortunately, we cannot add a timeline here, but we can do it with a timer, so let's add one. We're gonna move the cast to the timer and add a branch at the end to compare if the locations are almost same. If true, we're gonna increment the path step, but before that happens, we're gonna also check if it's the last step already, and if yes, stop the timer, where we will also assign the boolean to be back to false. To make our lives easier, we're gonna create a variable that's our palm itself on the begin play. Now on the false condition, we will increment the path step integer, and if the location is not almost equal, we're gonna move our palm towards it with the set actor location node, where the location is the lerp function. We're gonna grab our locations and connect them respectively. We're gonna also make a new float variable to control the alpha transition. It's gonna start with the value of 1 and will be decreased to 0 over time to make the transition between points, and one more float to control the speed. Let's call the timer on the button click and test it. Let's record some path and hit play. Oh, something's wrong here, but don't worry. Instead of checking if nearly equal, we're gonna check if equal or lower than 0. Also, we need to reset the transition alpha value back to 1 to repeat the process. Now let's try again. Alright, that's better now, but we don't have the reverse option yet. In order to do it, we need to use a branch first to check if we selected the reverse option. Move the actual piece of code to false and duplicate it to the true state. Here we will add a new array variable to keep track on the path locations list, reverse it and change the array reference to the variable we created. I was testing out the actual setup and it seems that I can do the process only once. That's because we didn't reset the path transition to alpha to 1 and path step back to 0. Now if you test it, it's gonna work flawlessly. Just look at this. You could easily add rotation to it instead of having it free and allowing to spectate around, but it's up to you. For now, we've created some more advanced pawn that can save locations he can teleport to, can record and replay path, and the best one, it can get upside down. So cool! The project, as usually, hosted on my Google Drive, link in the description. You waited for this pretty long, guys, but finally your questions have been answered. Or at least I hope so. Thanks for watching this video and see you next time. Cheers!